minutes. So I think what we need to define is what is young, and the definitions of young grossly vary in literature. Young can be someone who has been is 30 years, and Ranawat in his studies describes young as 55 years. The reason to absolutely discuss the young arthritic knee is the impact of this young arthritic knee on the economic as well as the social burden of our society. If you look at the Indian Joint Registry, almost about 15% of all knee replacements per year are done for patients who are less than 55 years of age. So the statistics that we have through various studies conducted through social groups are absolutely mind-boggling. So almost about 40% of all Indians above the age of 40 suffer from some knee pain in your life. I'm sure all of you would have had some knee pain in their lifetime as well. And almost about 80% of all patients who've got established knee OA would have some limitation of movements, and a fourth of them cannot perform their daily activities. So that's a very interesting study that was carried out by one of these organizations. They took about 100,000 or a lakh individuals who are above the age of 45, and they interviewed them. About a fourth, that is about 25,000 of them, had 4 weeks of knee pain in the previous year. A further half of them, that is almost about 12,500 patients or individuals, had knee pain with some amount of disability. A further half of them had disability as well as osteoarthritic changes on x-rays. And 2% of all the population had severe disability and severe osteoarthritis. So with such amount of statistics, and we can correlate them to our population of India, which is roughly around 6 to 7 crore plus, I think we have a huge number of people who have got osteoarthritis. The incidence of arthritis is on the rise, especially in the younger patients, because of post-trauma. We see a lot of trauma right now in which the upper end of the tibia and the lower end of the femur get involved quite commonly. The incidence of inflammatory arthritis is on the rise, though we have better medical management, but even then this is on the rise with all these inflammatory arthropathies as well. Younger patients are more important to tackle because the activity level between the younger patient and the older patient is definitely different. So on an average, you would find that the older patient walks about 1,200 steps in a day, whereas the patient who is younger than 60 years walks almost about 5,000 steps a day. So that's like a huge difference in the amount of activity levels, and this is what we need to consider, because any form of restorative surgery or medical management that you plan is going to lead to has going to have impact on the final outcomes. So younger patients are different because of absolutely higher activity levels, higher demands, and essentially poor compliance, which is what we need to look into. Cartilage, as we know, has a very poor capacity to repair, and this has been known since time immemorial. So essentially, once you have chondral damage, it's going to be a steady slow cascade, which slowly, progressively worsens, and almost 90% of all chondral injuries which start young will progress to some amount of osteoarthritis, and that is what we need to consider. So if you look at the pyramid of treatment of this cartilage injuries and the young arthritic knee, you have a variety of treatment options that are available. Right at the lowest, you have all the lifestyle modification, education, weight loss, etc., all the general modalities, to some oral medication and topical medication. And then you move on to the more interventions like using braces, insoles, and then doing injections like viscosupplementation or synovial restoration therapy, and finally surgical treatment. The treatment options, if you look at the meta-analysis of all the dilemmas in management, you can basically divide them into two groups, the non-surgical and the surgical group, and I'll very briefly just touch upon all of these aspects one by one without really going into details of the same, because as I did say, each of these are a topic in itself. So education, lifestyle advice, coping strategies, and behavioral and environmental changes, I think these are very all important, and I'm not going to spend time talking about them because time is quite short. Also, physical modalities and mechanical interventions are important as well. Let's look at the interventions, because we are all orthopedic surgeons and we all like to intervene to provide our patients the maximum amount of comfort. So lateral wedge insoles have been recommended by the AAOS because they also decrease the compressive load on the medial compartment, and they're also going to decrease the pain. And when we walk, we do have these dynamic adduction movements. These are normal adduction movements that occur at the knee in response to the ground reaction force. So whenever we walk, even if we have a good alignment, almost about 60 to 80% of our load will go through the medial compartment of the knee joint, And in osteoarthritis, when you have a varus deformity, then this is almost leads to 100% medial amount of load. So now these become from a physiological dynamic adduction movement, and now they become a pathological compression force in the osteoarthritic knee, which causes almost 100% compression on the medial side. So insoles and bracing help definitely by decreasing the amount of knee varus. And once you decrease the knee varus and apply a laterally based thrust, then there's definite opening of the medial joint line, and this allows the joint to unload. And once you unload the joint, you have restoration of your dynamic adduction movement. So you change from a pathological situation to a physiologic situation, which is very important. So this is a good study in which they looked at about 24 patients who were treated and observed over 2 weeks with reflective trackers. They had an unloader brace and they had a lateral wedge insole as well. And the results that they showed were that bracing helps significantly and lateral wedge insoles do not help as much as what a bracing would help, but definitely if you use both of them synergistically, the response is much more better. So bracing definitely helps. It helps improve the kinematics, it helps improve the gait pattern, it's going to help improve the stair climbing, it is going to decrease the pain, improve the function and decrease the amount of instability, and also has a good effect with neuromuscular control. So I think in my clinical practice with mild to moderate degrees of deformity, lateral wedge insoles along with bracing and physical therapy helps to a great extent. Viscosupplementation is another aspect that we use very frequently in clinical practice. Its use is predominantly for patients who have primary osteoarthritis and secondary osteoarthritis, which is non-inflammatory and is used in patients who are more than 30 years of age. Essentially, what we are doing is we are restoring the joint fluid by giving back the amount of hyaluronic acid that has been lost in the pathological process of osteoarthritis. The hyaluronic acid and its derivative that you inject essentially would have a mechanical effect, it will have a biological effect, and it would also have a viscoinductive effect through various cytokine-mediated pathways. There are different types of viscose supplements. All of them are not similar, and depending upon the one that you'd want to use, we normally find that the reticulated type of hyaluronic acid derivatives who have a molecular weight of more than 3 megadalton are the ones which are much more better than the linear ones for sure. What is most important when you do a visco is a strict intraarticular injection. It's often easier said than done. And it's not easy in a non-swollen joint, which is why studies have shown that you're likely to go wrong in your injection in almost about 10 to 30% of times. The preferred method to inject is what is called as the lateral lateropatellar technique, which has been shown by far to be the most efficient amongst all the injection techniques. There are a variety of tips and tricks which have been described. One is what is called as a backflow technique, in which you inject a bit of xylocaine, allow the xylocaine to backflow, which confirms that you're inside the joint, or the other is what is called as a squishing sound, in which you take a small air bubble in your syringe, inject it in, and confirm that the air has gone inside the knee joint. There is no role absolutely whatsoever of combining your visco with a steroid. In a very unusual situation where you have an acute inflamed swollen joint in the young arthritic knee, you can use a steroid first and then follow that up with a visco injection after a month or so. But there is no justification for combining both the injections together or combining a visco injection along with an oral steroid. So the indication in my practice in the young arthritic knee to use a visco would be a symptomatic individual who's got failure of medical management or who's intolerant to medical treatment and who does not have acute inflammation and synovitis. And there's definitely good role of the visco, especially for well-recognized OA, but there is no role in prophylaxis, which is very important. So just reiterating the indications once again. What is the next treatment that is available is surgical management, and arthroscopy is essentially limited in the young arthritic knee for treatment of symptomatic mechanical etiology. There's been a good study that was described, I think, in the Journal of Arthroscopy about 2 years ago, which was a meta-analysis, and they showed that when you did surgery for an arthritic knee in patients less than 55 years age who do not have mechanical symptoms, the expected time duration of relief was only about 3 months, versus if you had a mechanical pathology like a meniscus tear, Lourdes body, or a chondral flap, then the expected amount of relief was almost up to 9 to 12 months. If you combine your arthroscopy with a visco injection, then essentially they're supposed to have better pain relief and have extended benefit almost up to 1 year. And this has been shown in various studies in which you use it as an adjunct therapy to your cartilage treatment in the form of doing either a microfracture or doing a mosaicoplasty. If you have mechanical malalignment, I think an osteotomy of some type is very essential. It's very important because it helps protect your articular surface surgery, and alignment, as we know, is very crucial, whether it be joint preservation or whether it be joint replacement. Depending upon your expertise, you can choose to use either a closing wedge or an opening wedge osteotomy. One has to realize the nuances that if you do a closing wedge osteotomy, you're more likely to decrease the tibial slope. If you do an open wedge osteotomy, you're more likely to increase the tibial slope. So depending upon the patient's pathological tibial slope, you would want to choose either a medial or an open wedge osteotomy. If you have disease that is localized only to the medial compartment of the knee, which is going to be present in almost about 25% of your patients, you are more likely to experience a patient who's got anteromedial osteoarthritis. So an anteromedial osteoarthritis is a disease which is there only in extension, and this is what we'll demonstrate in the coming live surgery, and these are the patients who you should consider for doing a partial knee replacement. So uni is a very good tool for treating the patient with a young arthritic knee because it preserves the joint to a great extent, it preserves the cruciates, and because you're preserving both your cruciates, you have better proprioception, you have better range of motion, and better satisfaction rates at all. Essentially, all the controversy in literature has been because you've been comparing the UKR, which has been done for medial compartment arthritis, to a TKR, which has been done for a tricompartmental arthritis. Essentially, you should be comparing the results of a TKA versus a UKA done for medial compartment arthritis. And for all of you, all of those who like to look at results, in the recent Journal of Arthroplasty, there's a good study that has come from the Hospital of Special Surgery, which has been published by Andy Pearl, in which he's looked at these two groups. He's done a randomized trial of treating patients with isolated medial compartment arthritis with TKR and with UKR, and has shown far better results and survival with a UKR as compared to TKR as well. The long-term data of the uni is very encouraging, almost close to about 93% to 94% survival rates through various studies, even in the non-designer studies. So the primary indication for doing a partial knee would be an anteromedial osteoarthritis. And when we go through our live surgery, I'll take you through them. You need to have full thickness medial loss. You need to have a normal ACL, a normal MCL, and a normal lateral compartment. So if you have all these four criteria that are satisfied, I think that is the ideal patient to do a uni. And essentially, just to reiterate once again, the physiology or the pathology for an anteromedial osteoarthritis is a disease in extension in which you have preserved cartilage on the posterior tibia, posterior femur, and loss of cartilage in the anteromedial tibia and the anteromedial femur. So what happens is that you have loss of cartilage on the anterior side, you have an intact MCL, and when the patient flexes his knee, the deformity corrects, thereby the tension in the MCL is restored, and that is what is most important. Last but not the least, if you have got advanced arthritis, then you probably need to consider a knee replacement. And one of the good ways to ensure a good longevity of your knee replacement would be to have perfect alignment. We saw a fantastic example of the same by using a computer-assisted surgery. And definitely for the younger patient, you would need to consider all these forms of adjuncts, like using a different form of poly or different coating on your femoral as well as your tibial surfaces, which are going to be very important. So to conclude, I think the young arthritic knee is a topic in itself, which should extend over a day or two. You require a multimodal approach. Your treatment plan should be towards prevention or prevention of progression, and the whole gamut sort of extends from a non-surgical treatment to pharmacological methods to minimally invasive methods to invasive methods. And I think as far as all of us are concerned who are arthritis surgeons, we need to be well aware and well abreast of all the same technologies. So I thank you for allowing me to present this small talk on the young arthritic knee. I shall progress to the next talk, which is on instability after TKA. So why is it important to discuss instability after TKR? And I think if you look at these two papers, which won the John Insull Award, well, the first paper was published in 1998 by Tom Ferring, and he looked at 279 knee replacements, which were revised within 5 years of the index surgery. And what also constituted was that these absolutely constituted almost two-thirds of all revisions over the next 13 years, and 27% of them had instability. So about a fourth of all knees which fail early are because of instability. That's the first astonishing fact. And Sharkey again won the John Insull Award in 2006 in the core meeting, and he looked at again the same aspect, as that why are knees failing today. And you would observe that he looked at 212 knees which underwent revision. 50% of them were within 2 years of the index procedure, and the main cause for these 50% knees that were failing early were instability in a fourth of all cases. So instability comes number two after infection as one of the leading causes of early failures in joint replacement, and that's why we need to understand and know as to what is instability and how do we treat it. So essentially there are two failure modes when you look at instability. You could have failure of your soft tissues. So if the ligaments fail, as you know, we looked at the post-op X-ray, the MCL had failed, that's one mode of failure. Or you can have failure of the capsule, or you can have failure of your muscles. So if you have a quad tendon rupture or a quadriceps rupture, that's a soft tissue failure which leads to instability. Or you could have failure of your prosthesis, which could be either improper constraint or abnormal articular geometry. You could have certain patient factors which are important. Patients who have systemic connective tissue disorders like SLE, etc., tend to have poor connective tissue and they are more likely to fail. Patients who are very obese have got very abnormal strains, not only on their joints, but also on their capsular ligamentous structures. And those who have abnormal hip, foot, and ankle deformities leading to abnormal stresses on the joint line. Trauma seems to be another important factor. Someone who unfortunately ends up with an injury after a joint replacement could have instability. And the older designs, fortunately, which are not seen too much now, which are flat on flat designs, are more prone to getting instability problems. By far, the most important reason for instability are technical errors. And these are essentially inadequate balance of your flexion extension gap, joint line malpositioning, so if you have a joint line that is too high or too low, and malalignment as a result of improper bony cuts are going to be the main reasons why you get early instability in clinical practice. There are four main patterns of instability. You have extension instability, flexion, recurvatum, and midflexion. So I'm going to leave off the midflexion instability because we have a full talk that is dedicated to the same. It's very essential to examine these patients properly, and you need to test not just the AP stability, but we also need to test the varus valgus laxity in full extension, in 30 degrees of flexion and 90 degrees of flexion, because varying structures of our knee joint capsular ligamentous complex are stable or unstable at these three ranges of movements. You need to evaluate them properly by looking at full-length AP weight-bearing X-rays where you can pick up joint malalignments. You need to measure the anatomical and mechanical axes. And you also need to look at changes in the implant position, basically in full extension and flexion, because you may have subtle pistoning of implants because of loosening, which may predispose the patient to instability. So we'll look at extension instability first, and in the extension instability we have two types. You can have the symmetric or the asymmetric. The symmetric type of extension instability I think is something which is not a very difficult task to tackle. It's basically because you've resected too much of distal femur, which causes a loose extension gap and a tight flexion gap. It can also occur in some cases wherein you have laxity or the patient is hyperlax and you end up resecting the normal amount of femur and then you land up with a very large extension gap and a loose flexion gap. The treatment of the same is essentially to fill the extension gap and restore the flexion extension gap to being normal again. In a revision situation, if you try and compromise for such type of an asymmetric extension instability by just doing a poly insert, it will most often fail. So please be aware that if you have someone who's got extension instability 3, 4, 5 years down the track, please don't just do a poly exchange and come out. There is a very high chance that this isolated poly exchange will fail, and that's been shown through several elegantly performed studies. Only if you have a very elderly low demand patient who's got a well-aligned TKR for a long time, then only would I think of doing an isolated tibial insert exchange. The next pattern of instability is the asymmetric extension instability, and this could be either a varus type or a valgus type. So the typical example of an asymmetric extension instability is someone who's got a varus knee with tightly contracted medial structures, and essentially the surgeon who does the surgery is afraid of causing damage to the MCL, so he leaves the knee tight in on the medial side and has the patient having a normal LCL. So essentially there is lack of release on the medial side, which is an iatrogenic cause by the surgeon, and this is essentially due to fear of overcorrection to a valgus knee, and this will lead to abnormal polywear on the medial side, increase in varus, and then subsequent instability. Similarly, on the lateral side, you can have an asymmetric extension instability in valgus, and essentially this is because of overzealous release on the lateral side, and what has to be done in such situations is to change the constraint of the knee straight away intraoperatively, and one of the ways to prevent this problem is to do a pie cresting technique, which has been described by various authors like Scuderi, Laskin, Mihalko, and even recently Ranawat as well. Iatrogenic collateral ligament injury is probably one thing that we need to avoid. This leads to instability both in flexion and extension, and most commonly it would be an iatrogenic injury to the MCL because of failure to place our retractors properly. Less commonly it is to the popliteus or the patellar tendon. So CL is vulnerable at three occasions. One is when you expose the knee and when you're releasing of the anteromedial tibia. Next is when you're doing excising your meniscus. So it's always preferable to do your meniscus removal in extension, because that way you can see the fibers of the MCL and you can protect the MCL very carefully. And last is during the posterior condylar cut. And in a series that was picked up by Aaron Rosenberg's group, they looked at all the MCL injuries, and almost about 16 knees in 600 knees had some amount of injury to the MCL, which required suturing and with the form of various techniques. We'll next come to the flexion type of instability, and the flexion type of instability is very variable. You can have the very subtle type of flexion instability in which the patient complains that the knee is just not right. He has some sense of vague sense of instability to patients who've got frank dislocations as a result of either rupture of their PCL in the CR knee or when they have significant component loosening with failure of the soft tissues as well. Flexion instabilities are usually underdiagnosed, and you need to have a very high degree of suspicion, as what you can see in this patient here. He's got flexion instability because of mismatched flexion extension gaps, and even when you put patients in the figure of four position, you would find that the tibia subluxes, and these are the two tests that you should do to pick up flexion instability. Flexion instability is more common if you're doing a CR knee and you've not balanced the PCL, and there are specific reasons why this may occur. If you undersize the femur, if you give a very high tibial slope, or if you place the femoral component too anterior, then you're more likely to have instability in flexion. This will be an early type of instability. A late type of flexion instability is because of failure of the PCL, and this is because of late rupture of the PCL, or if you've not balanced the knee properly, you've got it tight on the medial side, lax on the lateral side, then you're going to have eccentric polywear on the posterior medial aspect, which is then going to re-give rise to flexion instability. In the PS, it's very uncommon to get flexion instability, and this is largely because your cam and post has a large jump height, and hence the incidence of flexion instability in a PS knee is less than 0.5%. The only possible place where you can find it is that if you've corrected a valgus knee to neutral and you have a very aggressive physical therapist, then that could be one person that you should be aware of. Asymmetric flexion instability is essentially because of abnormal malrotation of your femoral component. So instead of rotating it properly in align with the transepicondylar axis, if you have the femoral component internally rotated, then this may give rise to asymmetric flexion instability, which is again a technical error that you need to take into account. So prevention is of the same is either the use of navigation, as was elegantly demonstrated, or looking at your anatomical landmarks very carefully, and most effective would be to do the gap balancing technique. And I think we have a talk coming up which is going to elegantly describe how you do a gap balancing technique. What if you have a flexion instability? How do you treat it? If you have an undersized femur, then I think you need to shift to a larger size femur. You should add a wedge on the posterior aspect so that you restore the posterior condylar offset, and which becomes the important thing to have. If you have a high tibial slope, then you need to recut the tibia at 90 degrees or decrease the slope, and then it is better that you revise it to a PS and balance your flexion extension gap. If the cause of your flexion instability is a PCL rupture, then I think that's a no-brainer. You need to revise it to a PS design and have your flexion extension gaps balanced. Last, I'll talk about recurvatum instability, which is a very difficult problem. Fortunately for us, it is very rare, less than 1%. And the patients that we need to be aware of are the patients who've got neuromuscular disorders, like say poliomyelitis or syringomyelia, and those who've got severe inflammatory arthritis with compromise of their capsular ligament complex. So in the recurvatum, the key is to under-resect the distal femur and to use distal femoral blocks if required. If you use your standard resection techniques, measured resection techniques, there's a very high risk that you'll put your patient back into the same amount of hyperextension. So what you need to do is to resect less of distal femur, less of proximal tibia, and try and get these patients and keep them in almost about 10 to 15 degrees of flexion at the end of your procedure. If you're faced with some amount of global instability in which you have massive gaps and a large amount of flexion and recurvatum instability, the way to go is to shift them to a hinge which has an anterior bumper, and these are the kind of patients who are best preferred and treated with a hinge prosthesis. So if you have uncontrolled hyperextension with insufficiency of your posterior capsule, a hinge prosthesis will be the way to go. So to summarize, instability is an important cause, especially for early failures in your knee replacements. It ranks only second to infection as the cause of revision. The symptoms of instability can be very variable, right from a vague knee pain or vague sensation of give way to frank dislocations. Please look at the pre-op deformity and what sort of releases that were done. They're going to be very useful for you to plan your revision surgery. If you're doing a primary, please take care in balancing your flexion extension gaps and protect your collaterals. Treatment of instability is never simple. Braces will never work. Treatment is often a revision, and during a revision, usually you would need to go up one level of constraint. That is, if you've done a CR, you need to go to a PS. If you've done a PS, you need to go to some kind of a CCK prosthesis. And if you're in a CCK, probably you need to go to a hinge. Thank you very much once again.
This topic is for discussion. Sir, please stay on. Any questions from the audience?
Suppose you have got a patient who has undergone a CR knee and he sustains a PCL injury later. Can you exchange the poly to a deep dish and get away without going in for a PS?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. A lot of the newer systems now have the facility of using what is called as an AS CR insert, or an anterior stabilized or a deep dish type of an insert. And these newer type of inserts have got good congruency. And one can, if the components are well aligned, if the limb is well aligned and the components are well fixed, you can just do a poly exchange and you can get away with the same. Okay, thank you so very much.